This series is meant to be viewed in order to get the most benefit from it. If you haven't seen Soundproof Part 0.5, then please take a look at that video before watching this one in order to get the proper context. You can find a link to that video in the description below. Hello, and welcome to part one of Soundproof. We're going to be covering the controversial topic, music. I have so much to share with you, it's going to take some time, so I want to go ahead and jump right in. And I want to start by asking the question, why are we here? And by why are we here, I mean, why am I doing this four-part series on music and going into all this detail over what godly music is? And why are you watching this right now? Instead of answering that question with words, really, I want to show you why we're here right now. So let's take a look. Te adoraré, te adoraré. I'll be funny if the shadow of it me pass and just step on the enemies. I keep hand up in the knee. They make me feel invincible, earthquake powerful. I'm fine, I got my feet up. I ain't never scared, gonna put my heat up. I was outside in the dry, no rear. Well, double life, there's a louder life. What you just saw were various forms of so-called gospel music, gospel reggae, gospel rap, gospel rock and roll, gospel salsa, gospel heavy metal. Everything is being called gospel. How did we get to this point where you can barely distinguish between the world's music and the church's music? We're going to cover all of this in this series. We're going to start today by taking a brief journey to take a look at the history of gospel music. In this series, we're also going to cover melody and harmony and everyone's favorite topic, rhythm and drums. And we're also going to take a look at how the wrong kind of Christian music can affect us negatively. We have a lot to cover, so let's go ahead and dive right in by taking a look at a story that I love to cover and that we covered in a recent video, the story of Uzzah. In 2 Samuel chapter 6, we see the story of Uzzah, a man who was guiding the ark of God on an ox cart. And that ark began to fall off the cart, and Uzzah went to catch it, and God struck him dead right there in that moment. And this is a story that many people have struggled with in their Christian experience. But what most people don't understand is that the steps that it took for God and Uzzah to reach that place were the direct result of the children of Israel looking to the world, looking to the Philistines, and following what they were doing and trying to offer that up to God when they knew better. We'll read this story in 2 Samuel chapter 6. It says, "And David arose and went with all the people who were with him from Baal Judah to bring up from there the ark of God, whose name is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, who dwells between the cherubim. So they set the ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. And Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, drove the new cart. And they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill, accompanying the ark of God. And Ahio went before the ark. Then David and all the house of Israel played music before the Lord on all kinds of instruments, of fir wood, on harps, on stringed instruments, on tambourines, on sistrums, and on cymbals. And when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah put out his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen stumbled. Then the anger of the Lord was aroused against Uzzah, and God struck him there for his error, and he died there by the ark of God. And David became angry because of the Lord's outbreak against Uzzah, and he called the name of the place Perez Uzzah to this day." So what we have here is that the children of Israel were carrying the ark of God the way they saw the Philistines carry it, when they knew that they were supposed to carry it on staves. In other words, they were looking to the world, they were taking what was holy, and they were putting it on top of something that was unholy. And this is going to become very clear as we look at the music, because what we saw in that music clip in the beginning is that what is holy is being placed on something that is unholy, and we're going to find out why it is unholy. But David was angry at God for reacting the way that he did when the children of Israel were the ones that were in error. Let's go on. David saw his mistake. And in 1 Chronicles chapter 15, he looked to remedy this mistake. And it says, "And David made him houses in the city of David and prepared a place for the ark of God and pitched for it a tent. Then David said, 'None ought to carry the ark of God but the Levites, for them hath the Lord chosen to carry the ark of God and to minister unto him forever.' And David gathered all Israel together to Jerusalem to bring up the ark of the Lord unto his place, which he had prepared for it. Now look at what David says. And said unto them, ye are the chief of the fathers of the Levites. Sanctify yourselves, both ye and your brethren, that ye may bring up the ark of the Lord God of Israel unto the place that I have prepared for it. For because ye did it not at the first, the Lord our God made a breach upon us, for that we sought him not after the due order. And there it is, the due order. We're going to find out what the due order is. Often when we're talking about music, it seems a little mysterious. And oftentimes we find ourselves saying that we can't really know what godly music is, but we are going to see that we can absolutely know what the principles of godly music are, and then we will have to make that choice whether or not we're going to fall in line with that due order. Before we dive in, I want to make a very important point, and I'm going to make it over and over again throughout this series. I am not the music police, and you are not the music police either. Everybody has a conscience, everybody has a mind, and we merely need to take this information, process it ourselves, go to God, and he will direct and guide us in what we need to do. And I hope that we can keep that in mind. So let's go ahead and jump right in. Why did we call this soundproof? Romans chapter 12, verse 2 says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Soundproof. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, it says, prove all things, hold fast to that which is good. So this is what we want to do today. We want to provide proof, and we want to hold fast to that which is good. In this series, we're going to follow a couple of rules, and basically it's that I don't know anything. I am not a musician, and so I'm not expecting anyone to listen to me. But what we're going to do is use three sources. Number one, the Bible. Number two, the spirit of prophecy. And number three, the experts on music. So that we can follow this principle, in the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. Now that all of that is out of the way, we're going to take a look at a video clip from a documentary called The Devil's Music, talking about jazz music. But I want to read just a couple of things before we look at that, really dig into this. This is a statement taken from First Testimonies, page 497. It says, the introduction of music into their homes instead of inciting to holiness and spirituality has been the means of diverting their minds from the truth. Frivolous songs and the popular sheet music of the day seem congenial to their taste. The instruments of music have taken time which should have been devoted to prayer. Music, when not abused, is a great blessing, but when put to a wrong use, it is a terrible curse. It excites, but does not impart that strength and courage which the Christian can find only at the throne of grace. So as I already said, jazz music is laid at the foundation of modern day gospel music. So let's take a look at a clip from this documentary named The Devil's Music to get an understanding of where this music came from and how it's affecting modern day gospel music.
As America entered the 20th century, a new music emerged that was unlike anything heard before. A liberating music, a sensuous music.
Jazz was for the F word. He jazzed her. See, jazz sometimes spelled J-double-S, but J-double-Z had a definite sexual connotation. Something illegal, something forbidden, therefore something quite desirable too.
Through World War I and into the 1920s, the intoxicating sounds of jazz were spreading across America. At the same time, a growing controversy was developing over what some people considered the dangerous influence of this music. Many states enacted laws to try to stop the spread of jazz. By the end of the 1920s, at least 60 communities across America had prohibited jazz in public dance halls. Clergy, politicians, parents, professors argued against the evils of jazz.
So much was said there, and I hope that you were paying attention. But if not, let's go ahead and take a look at a few things that were said. Number one, it was called the devil's music. They said that it was liberating, sensuous. It was connected with the F word. It had a definite sexual connotation. It was illegal, forbidden, intoxicating. There were even laws to stop the spread. 60 communities prohibited jazz. Clergy, politicians, parents, professors, all tried to stop the spread of this music. Now, I want you to keep in mind that the people that were interviewed in this video were not necessarily Christians, and so they're just going to speak openly and honestly about what it is. But what we're going to see in a moment is that jazz was taken by a gentleman named Thomas Dorsey, who was called the father of gospel music, and he used the jazz rhythms and the jazz melodies, brought it into the church, and baptized it, and this became the foundation of modern gospel music. So if what these experts are saying is correct, modern gospel music is built on something that is liberating, sensuous, connected with the F word, has a sexual connotation, is illegal, is forbidden, and is intoxicating. And remember, I didn't say it, the people that were being interviewed did. It says, jazz is a music genre that originated at the beginning of the 20th century. Its roots lie in the combining of African rhythms of certain European harmony and form elements with their existing African-based music. Its African musical basis is evident in its use of blue notes, improvisation, polyrhythms, syncopation, and the swung note. From its early development until the present day, jazz has also incorporated elements from popular music, especially in its early days from American popular music. So who is this gentleman that I talked about, named Thomas Dorsey, that took hold of jazz music and blended it with gospel? It says, during the early 1930s, Thomas Dorsey created gospel music, the religious music which married secular blues to a sacred text. So here we see the blending and the marriage of the secular and the sacred, very similar to what the children of Israel did when they put that holy ark on top of an ox cart. So with this in mind, let's take a quick look at a clip from a documentary on the history of gospel music talking about Thomas Dorsey.
But their musical needs were required in the context of worship, a new music, something that addressed their struggles and their hardships at that time in those places. The challenges that they met in the city as factory workers were quite different from those that they experienced as sharecroppers.
Thomas Dorsey was basically a blues singer. He called himself Georgia Tom, and for most of the 1920s he made quite a bit of money by singing off-color blues. Then suddenly he experienced, as many people do, sort of an epiphany, a revelation. He lost a lot of money suddenly. He took that as some kind of sign, and he began to turn his considerable songwriting talents to gospel music.
We affectionately refer to him as the godfather of gospel because he sophisticated the call and response technique, which came via the oral tradition from West Africa, and he introduced the so-called jazz cadences and rhythms of popular music into the gospel idiom.
There's something very important that was said that we need to address as we're talking about this topic. It says that this music was needed to address the needs of people in impoverished communities. And so we never want to overlook the fact that people have a emotional connection with music, and oftentimes the music that they're listening to helps get them through certain situations. And so we want to be sensitive to that. But we also want to understand that we need to understand the biblical principles of this, because remember, the music can be having a negative effect on people spiritually without them even realizing it. And so we need to keep that in mind. But basically it says that Thomas Dorsey introduced jazz cadences and rhythms from the popular gospel music, or I could say the pop music, into gospel music. And the same thing is taking place today, and we're going to see it very clearly. So this was Dorsey's formula. It says, as formulated by Dorsey, gospel music combines Christian praise with the rhythms of jazz and blues, which we know is the devil's music. By the way, we're going to understand why people called it the devil's music in parts 2 and 3 of this series when we look at melody and harmony and rhythm. But let's take this principle of combining the holy and the unholy and see if it stands up to what the Bible has to say, the principles from Scripture. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14. It says, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? So this verse is basically saying that righteousness and unrighteousness cannot be combined. When I first started learning about this topic, going back almost 20 years, I learned from my brother-in-law, Emeka, and his friend David Withers. They used to go around and do a music program, and they would read this text. And when they would read it, they would interpret it and use these exact words. What fellowship hath godly words with ungodly music? This is the question that we need to ask ourselves. Now, when Thomas Dorsey started blending these two things together, this is an account of how the church reacted. It says in his essay, Rock Church Rock, Arne Bontemps says that it was then that Dorsey began to write religious music, abandoning his brash lyrics, but not the jazz rhythms and blues flavor and rhythmic style so akin to Tindley's own. Naturally, the old guard conservatives considered this blending of the sacred, spirituals and hymns, and the secular, blues and jazz, as the devil's music and shunned it. So when this was going on, the church condemned it. They said this music should not be allowed inside the church. And look at how far we've come since that time. That's why there's something called creeping compromise. It starts little by little until you get to the point where there is absolutely no difference between what the world's music is and what the church's music is. And obviously, it did not stop with Thomas Dorsey. The next person up was a woman by the name of Rosetta Tharpe. It says she gained popularity in the 1930s and 1940s with her gospel recordings characterized by a unique mixture of spiritual lyrics and electric guitar. She was the first great recording star of gospel music and was among the first gospel musicians to appeal to rhythm and blues and rock and roll audiences, later being referred to as the original soul sister and the godmother of rock and roll. And we need to pause right here for a moment, because with Rosetta Tharpe, she borrowed music from jazz and blues, then she made it her own, and then actually rock and roll people started borrowing from her. So this same thing that happened recently with Beyoncé, this big dust-up with her taking music from the Clark sisters and putting it into her music, this is exactly what happened with Rosetta Tharpe. But remember, the gospel music was taken from the world in the first place, so it was theirs, and now the world is just borrowing it back, so we can't go around getting upset about that. But anyway, I digress. This article goes on to say, willing to cross the line between sacred and secular by performing her music of light in the darkness of nightclubs and concert halls with big bands behind her, Tharpe pushed spiritual music into the mainstream and helped pioneer the rise of pop gospel. So let's see how this happened by taking a look at another clip from this documentary on the history of gospel music.
The Golden Gate Jubilee Quartet, an a cappella quartet who managed to sing both religious and secular songs with unparalleled charm and virtuosity, became an important popular act. They appeared at the White House. They did national radio broadcasts. Sister Rosetta Tharpe, who represented the sanctified tradition, she came from the Pentecostal denomination, the Church of God in Christ. She introduced the virtuosic guitar and showmanly an extremely stylized vocalist genre to the world.
Up above my head, I hear music in the air. Up above my head, I hear music in the air.
Sister Tharpe was the first mega star in gospel. By the mid-40s, she was packing in 30,000 people. Rosetta learned to play the guitar from blues and jazz singers. And that stuck with her. Not only did she like the way they played the guitar, she liked the music that they sang. Now, her mother was sanctified, so her mother wanted her to sing gospel music. And Rosetta would sing gospel music. But her ear was always over there to the great blues guitarists and the jazz guitarists, because that's what she played. And she would let that music seep in so that this month she was singing gospel. And next month, she'd be at the Cotton Club.
Look down, that lonesome road before you travel on. Look up, oh, look up, and see your maker before Gabriel blow his horn.
So this is what the experts had to say. She learned to play from blues and jazz musicians. Her mother was sanctified and did not approve of her playing certain types of music. She always had her ear to the blues and jazz guitarists. She would let that music seep in. One month she was singing gospel, and the next she was back in the bars. Now remember, these are not my words. This is what the experts are saying. This is what the people who understand the history of gospel music are saying very openly, very casually, because it is what it is. This is the truth of the matter. It's a blending of the unholy and the holy. So let's go ahead and put this to the test of scripture to see if it holds up. This is Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. It says, "No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve God and man." So if we're in a position where there's a gospel artist that's keeping their ear to what the world is doing, in and out of church, going from church to bars to play music, then we have a problem. We can understand that this person is serving two masters, and they may not be able to offer us something that is going to be of the best benefit for our spirituality. Now, this doesn't mean that someone who's doing this can't produce music that is godly and that can feed someone's soul. But what we have to understand as a whole, in its entirety, the history of gospel music is founded on this principle of mixing these two things. And so we have to keep this in mind. And so the story goes on, and I want us to take a look at another clip from this documentary to understand how this use of pop music and rhythm and blues and jazz continue to fuel gospel music as the music continued to move forward.
The question that was raised when gospel was performed first at the Newport Jazz Festival was whether this was an appropriate context for gospel music, given the fact that it was secular and that jazz had always carried the stigma of immorality in various dimensions with it. But the answer to the question was that one should reach out for the sinners. One should reach out to new converts, and that this was one way of achieving that.
Friends, that's the way we would like for you to enjoy this service this afternoon, just like you're doing. We'd like to know that you can clap your hands, and if you want to holler at the girls, you do that. Religion and jazz. That's what we're representing, religion this afternoon.
Oh, thank God.
If you hear a preacher like Shirley Caesar testify, she is always bringing matters home. She's always talking about the problems of her audience, their inability to meet bills, the danger of crime and drugs in the street, the problem of AIDS in the community. And I've also described gospel as kind of a cosmic blues, because it's the only form that deals with some of more gloomy and melancholy experiences.
Okay, so it was talking about this jazz and blues festival that took place every year. And this was a pivotal year when these women showed up, these gospel singers showed up to take part in this gathering. And this was sort of a turning point in the music reaching the masses. But let's take a look at what was said about this event. Obviously, it was a secular gathering. And the woman said, if you want to holler at the girls, you can go right ahead and holler at the girls. She said, we are representing religion and jazz. And one of the people also reiterated the fact that jazz continued to carry that stigma of being immoral. Because remember, it was called the devil's music. It drove people to do certain types of things, certain types of dancing, to put themselves in certain types of situations. And so this is what was being carried into the church, and many people had a problem with it. But the key thing to remember about this is that people did have pure motives. They wanted to use this as a way to reach sinners. And I can certainly understand that something can have pure motives. But just because something has pure motives, it does not mean that it's acceptable to God, and it does not mean that it's going to end up blessing others in the way that God wants them to be blessed. I want you to understand this clearly by taking a look at this quote from Prophets and Kings, page 570. It says, there is a constant danger that professing Christians will come to think that in order to have influence with worldlings, they must to a certain extent conform to the world. But though such a course may appear to afford great advantages, it always ends in spiritual loss. I want to read that again. It always ends in spiritual loss. Pure motives cannot take something that is unrighteous and make it pure. And unfortunately, because of a desire to reach the world where they are and with their kind of music, people have made these decisions to push gospel music, to push Christian music in a direction that should have never taken place. And so as a result, this is why we're at this place where we're having to have this conversation. And it's a very difficult conversation because things have gone so far that we can't even understand the difference between what is right and wrong anymore. But this is why we're having this conversation. So what does God think about this idea of altering the way that we worship by taking a look at what other people are doing? This is Deuteronomy chapter 12, verses 30 and 31. This is talking about when the children of Israel were getting ready to go into the promised land. And when they went there, they were going to see various people worshiping their gods in a particular way. And this is what God had to say. He said, "Take heed to thyself, that thou be not snared by following them, after that they be destroyed from before thee, and that thou inquire not after their gods, saying, how did these nations serve their gods? Even so will I do likewise. Thou shalt not do so unto the Lord thy God." For the New International Version puts it this way: "You must not worship the Lord your God in their way." This has always happened. It happened in the early period of Christianity, when people took the idols of the pagans and simply changed the name because they wanted to reach the unchurched, because they wanted to reach the pagans. And so this is how idolatry came in and took hold of the church during that early period of Christianity. This is a quote talking about what happened when Christians took these pagan idols and brought them into the church. It says, "The statues of the gods from the Pantheon are now found in the Vatican Museum, with the exception of the great statue of Jupiter, which has been modified, retitled, and seated on a throne in St. Peter's Basilica in Rome as St. Peter. Thousands of pilgrims kiss the foot of Jupiter while thinking it is the statue of Peter." And I hope you caught that. Every year, thousands of people walk up to this statue and kiss the foot of what they believe to be St. Peter. They shouldn't be doing it anyway, but they believe they're kissing the foot of a Christian, and they're actually kissing the foot of a pagan god. Just like today, many people believe that they're listening to what is Christian music, but in actuality, it is jazz, rhythm and blues, rock and roll, heavy metal, rap, salsa, R&B, whatever you think of, it is all these wrong types of music repackaged and sold to the people as something that is Christian, when in actuality, it is no different from the repurposed idols that were used during the Dark Ages and that you can find today in Catholic churches all around the world. Now, when these early Christians started trying to use these methods to reach the unchurched, did it work? This is a statement from Great Controversy, page 58. It says, "Many who professed conversion still clung to the tenets of their pagan philosophy, and not only continued its study themselves, but urged it upon others as a means of extending their influence among the heathen." Basically, what we're seeing today is the same exact thing. People listen to the wrong kind of music when they're in the world. And then when they come into the church, the ear is still to that music. And so people want to cling to it. And so the beats and the style of music are brought into the church, and it's urged upon people that this will be a way, a better way, of people who listen to that type of music so that they can be brought to Christ. But more times than not, it will not lead to true spirituality. So now let's continue our journey of figuring out how we got here by taking a look at the next person that pushed the genre forward, James Cleveland.
It's called the Crowned Prince of Gospel. And I see James Cleveland as the heir apparent to Dorsey. He imitated everything that Dorsey did. For example, Dorsey played the piano, Dorsey sang, he organized choirs, he composed songs. For perhaps 30 years, he was the biggest selling artist in gospel music, and he followed every shift. If the music became closer to rock and roll, to pop music, Cleveland was in the vanguard. And yet,
as I said, he had immediate access to the oldest sounds. He could work with a quartet, he could work with a soloist, he could work with a group, he could work with a choir. He understood the whole genre.
When you're dealing with folk that have traditional mindsets with, concerning gospel music, they don't allow any leeway for going outside of those boundary lines. I find with those that are not churched, with those executives that are not churched, that they tend to have a broader scope on what to do with the gospel music, or try different things that are outside the traditional norm.
All right, so this is what the experts had to say about James Cleveland and his role in the continued pushing forward of modern-day gospel music. It says that he followed every shift in popular music. If the music went towards rock or to pop, so did he. Cleveland was at the vanguard. So again, we have another pioneer that is simply following exactly what the world is doing and is bringing it into the church. And really the statement that most resonated with me, the gospel artist that made this statement, the church did not want to go outside of the guidelines, but the unchurched executives were willing to go outside of those boundaries. Of course they were willing to go outside of the boundaries. Why? Because they're unchurched. Their role is to try to make money. And so we have this situation that every single step in this progression of gospel music, that there are people who are trying to stand up and say, this is not right. But unfortunately, this following of what the world was doing continued to move forward. The foundation of modern gospel music continued to be laid on something that was ungodly. So how should we feel about this? This is Psalms chapter 127, verse 1. It says, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. If God is not building the house, then obviously it is built upon a false foundation. And eventually, if our spiritual experience is founded on a false foundation, eventually it will crumble. Matthew chapter 7 goes on to say, even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. So if we look at this and we understand that the roots, the soil, is corrupted with jazz, rhythm and blues, R&B, rock and roll, rap, whatever it is, obviously that soil is going to be tainted. And so the tree of modern gospel music that is soaking up all of that will bear fruit that does not bring godliness, purity, and spirituality into our lives, because you cannot separate the music from the words. The influence will always be there, because there will always be some type of corrupt influence on a music that is founded on these principles. Now, this battle in the church has always been there, and it was even there for a song named Oh Happy Day. And when I first saw this clip that you're about to see, my mind was blown, because I couldn't understand how this song was frowned upon at the time. So let's go ahead and take a look at the clip, and you'll understand what I'm saying, and then we'll make a few points.
Now, a fabulous thing happened in the pop music world a little while ago. An American choir recorded a Negro spiritual, which went straight to the top of the charts in America and on this side of the Atlantic. You'll probably know the song, Oh Happy Day. I'm delighted to say they're visiting the country at the moment, and this is their first appearance in this country, and I'm delighted to say that it's on my show. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like you to meet the Edwin Hawkins Singers.
What they did was they changed the face of gospel music for their time period during the 60s. They made it more urban, more mainstream. Now to listen to Oh Happy Day, the children of this day, the gospel listeners of this day, consider that traditional music. When I was growing up, that music wasn't allowed to be played in the church. And even in our homes, they wouldn't allow us to play because it sounded too world.
And so that gospel artist that was talking about this song, he says that when we look at it now, that's looked at as traditional. But he said when it first got released, they couldn't even listen to it in church because it was too worldly. As a matter of fact, parents would not even let their children listen to it at home. I couldn't even fathom this when I first saw this clip. But it really just goes to show how far removed we are from the purity of music that a song like this that we look at as regular and traditional was actually controversial when it first came out. And I hear it right now. It happens every time we do this program. The hearts are breaking. Because obviously, if this music is bad, then heaven help us. What can we listen to? And really, honestly, I don't want to overwhelm anyone, but we just need to be prayerfully understanding the principles that are being laid forth, and then we can go back to God, and God will guide us in what we need to listen to and what we need to reject. So basically, what have we seen? Gospel music has changed and mimicked secular music every single step of the way. And so now what we're going to do is listen to clips from gospel music, and then we're going to see where they got the inspiration from the song, the style of music, the style of singing, and we're going to see very clearly the principles that we have looked at laid out. Make this point as clear as possible. We're going to take a little bit of a journey through the decades of gospel music. So let's start with the 1950s. Right, so I hope you heard that, the singing, the music, even that little riff at the end, and let's go ahead and listen to the secular counterpart.
To do things for your memory's sake, it's a beauty. See if you remember this as Sam Cooke sings, "You Send Me."
Darling, you send me.
All right, so that should be clear. So let's go ahead and jump forward to the 1970s. Now remember, listen to the style of music, and then we're going to hear the secular counterpart to see where the inspiration was coming from. Right, so in those songs, you can hear the guitar, you can hear the bass line. All of these similarities of the music are clearly seen and evident, and it matches what we've already looked at so far, that gospel, modern gospel music, pop gospel music, was simply mimicking what the world was doing at every single step of the way. And at every single step of the way, there was always this sort of war in the churches of what should be considered godly. All right, now, so let's go ahead and jump to the 1990s and listen to a little piece of music, a little piece of gospel music from that era. All right, so that should be clear what you just heard, the continued mimicking. But this next clip that we're going to look at is really going to start something that is even deeper, because what gospel artists eventually started to do is taking the exact song and simply just changing a few words and then calling it gospel music. So I want us to take a look at a couple of examples of those where it's basically just a direct replica.
Everyone, everywhere I go, tell me, have you heard? Tell me, do you know? Do you know him? Yeah. Tell me, do you know him?
Oh, I see her face. Mary show. Have you seen her? Tell me, have you seen her?
And so you see there that song, Have You Seen Her? The words and the music were taken and simply shifted to be, Do You Know Him? Tell Me, Do You Know Him? Next up, we'll take a look at a rap song entitled In the Church.
Go, 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 children, it's a Sunday, hallelujah, amen, it's Sunday. If you find me in the church, praying with the preacher, the deacon, that's what we need. If you really love the Lord, I'm into getting blessed, so I'm stepping through the door. Come and lift them up, one God, one love.
Right, so that was a gospel rap song entitled In the Church. Nothing wrong with being found in the church, but here we're going to see that the inspiration was drawn directly from an artist named 50 Cent with a song in the club.
Go shorty, it's your birthday. We gon' party like it's your birthday. We gon' sip a card like it's your birthday. You can find me in the club, bottle full of bub. Mama, I got what you need if you need to fill a bar.
All right, we're almost done. This is another example of a modern-day gospel song that is borrowing its sound exactly from R&B. All right, and when this song came out, it was shortly after another R&B song, a very popular R&B song, had come out. I believe it was named Blame It on the Alcohol.
Blame it on the booze, got you feeling loose. Blame it on the drone, got you feeling gone.
And so right now, I just want to give two modern day examples of this because really, I just wanted to make sure that we touched on as many decades as possible so that no matter who's listening, we can understand that this same exact thing has always been taking place.
Ain't no pardons in the garden if you snake me. You can't break me. Trying to chase me.
Turf my dope, might be the same. Mama, Caesar. Ooh, I'm getting fly like an eagle. Ooh, I wear more Gucci than Gucci.
Hey, baby.
In the beginning of this presentation, I asked the question, how did we get here? And I played various forms of music, rock and roll, heavy metal, rap, R&B, reggae, salsa. We got here because the modern music is based on this principle of blending the holy with the profane. So what do you think about it? What does God think about it? Do we need to continue pursuing something new? Do we need to keep copying what the world is doing in order to reach the world? I believe God answers that question in Jeremiah 6, verse 16. It says, Thus saith the Lord, Stand ye in the ways and see, and ask for the old paths, where is the good way, and walk therein, and ye shall find rest for your souls. But they said, We will not walk therein. It's always been like this. God's people have always been looking for something new, something exciting to scratch the itch. When God is saying, Listen, seek the old paths, and you will find rest for your souls. I believe that people are sincerely looking for peace. I believe that there are many people who are sincerely looking for a personal relationship with Christ. Many believe that they can obtain it through music. But we need to understand that what we're offering to God cannot be what we like. We have to go to God. We have to ask Him what He desires. And we have to follow Him after the due order. How important is it to understand the principles of music? This is from Patriarchs and Prophets, page 594. It says, Music forms a part of God's worship in the courts above, and we should endeavor in our songs of praise to approach as nearly as possible to the harmony of the heavenly choirs. Singing as a part of religious service is as much an act of worship as is prayer. The heart must feel the spirit of the song to give it right expression. This statement is so important because it's saying that in our understanding, we need to strive as much as possible to reach the style and the harmony of the heavenly choirs. This means that we need to understand the biblical principles of music. And that's why in part two of this series, we'll go ahead and look at melody and harmony to find out if the Bible, the spirit of prophecy, and the experts can help us to understand what is the proper use of melody and harmony. And don't worry, in part three, we'll get to everybody's favorite topic, rhythm, to understand how this plays into what is godly music. And so as we close, I'd like for us to end with the verse that we read in the beginning. It says, "Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." It's obvious that modern-day gospel music has been conformed to the world. And so God is looking for us to prove what kind of music and sounds are acceptable to Him. Sound proof. And it's my prayer that as we continue on in this journey, that you will be willing to do the perfect will of God as we find out together what is the due order. Hope to see you again for part two of Soundproof.